The International Brigade boasted many famous literary names who, like moths to a flame, were inexorably drawn to fight on the side of the Republican government in 1936. Hemingway, Orwell, Auden, Laurie Lee. Some, like the poet John Cornford, who gave his life for the Republic one day after his 21st birthday, fought and died for their ideals. Intellectuals from every country fought side by side with anti-Nazi German veterans, escapees from concentration camps, Russian communists, Italian anti-fascists, Irishmen, Hungarians and Poles. They fought and killed their own countrymen on the opposite side. In literature and painting, as here in Dali's work, Premonition of Civil War, there was a fervent outpouring of emotion. Coordinated risings began all over Spain on the 18th of July, and within 4 days, the insurgent military, some of whom were under the command of Generals Francisco Franco and Emilio Mola, controlled about one-third of the country. The refusal of the government to accept the seriousness of the situation and only arm the civilian population once the rising was well underway was a decision that proved fatal. While Britain dithered, Germany and Italy reacted swiftly to Franco's appeal for assistance.
The news that had been coming in from diplomats in Spain, particularly the consuls, was that Spain was in a state of anarchy, that at least one British businessman had been shot, that there were wildcat strikes all over the country, and this was blamed on what the diplomats termed the communists, by whom they seem to have meant not just the pro-Moscow Communist Party, but principally the libertarian communists, as they called themselves in Spain, of the anarchist movement. So that the British government's view of what happened in Spain was that a military rebellion was not to be unexpected. This was usual when a country like that, which they didn't have very much respect for, slid into a state of disorder. But they were particularly concerned about the possibility of the spread of Soviet influence of revolution in a country in which British business had a number of interests.
Italy sent 12 bombers, and the German battleship Deutschland, docking at Ceuta in Morocco, was followed by a German torpedo boat and 6 Heinkel fighter planes. In Gibraltar, the British refused oil to the government, while permitting the insurgents to use the telephone lines for communications to Italy, Germany, and Portugal, which also sided with Franco, and eventually sent 20,000 troops in support. Hitler had recognized an excellent chance for his pilots and reconnaissance men to gain valuable experience in wartime conditions. Franco, the youngest ever general in Spain, was named as head of government on September the 29th. His ambitions were already clear. By October the 1st, he was calling himself head of state. Under the Estado de Guerra, martial law, truckloads of political suspects, the red oppressors, as Franco called them, were taken to the outskirts of the town and the prisoners massacred. 20,000 of them in the first weeks of the war. September found the government in deep trouble. The siege of the Alcázar in Toledo symbolized their inability to make progress in the field. On the 7th of October, the capital Madrid witnessed the first airstrikes on the city. The grim battle for the heart of Spain was underway. The nationalist armies were approaching from the northwest and southwest, and by the middle of the month, all towns within 15 miles were in their hands. Popular Front soldiers, the Milicianos, were capable of astounding courage and bravery, but were undisciplined and lost huge numbers of men through inexperience and the refusal to take cover or dig trenches. The nationalists gained ground steadily. And by the 8th of November, were in the university buildings despite fierce resistance. Refugees flooded into the already crowded city and were joined on the 8th by the first recruits of the 11th International Brigade. The eyes of the world were on Madrid. If it fell to the insurgents, the moral victory alone would be devastating for the government. But Franco had not reckoned with the determination of the people of Madrid, the Madrileños. They fought with selfless bravery and the words of a woman who became a legend ringing in their ears. Dolores Ibarruri, a communist deputy known as La Pasionaria, had already stirred the hearts of the Madrileños at the outbreak of the war with her defiance. "Resist, resist, resist," she had said. "To your last gasp, to your last drop of blood, resist. Fight with any weapon. Pour boiling water on the traitors. Gouge out their eyes with kitchen knives. Resist. It is better to die on your feet than to live on your knees. No pasarán. They shall not pass." Now she repeated the cry, and the people of Madrid responded by transforming their beloved city into a fortress. For 10 days, the conflict raged. Bombs tore into the buildings as the German and Italian planes unleashed their destruction. On the 17th of November, 2,000 missiles were falling on the city center every hour, and incendiaries turned the beautiful squares and noble buildings into raging infernos as the German bombers swooped 12 at a time. In a city with no air raid shelters, the results were devastating. Even the ruthless Moroccan troops were unable to break the steel will of the badly armed Madrileños. Children helped to build barricades in the streets. A battalion of women shouldered arms and stood to face the enemy. After bloody fighting in the university buildings, the nationalist advance was checked, the main assault repulsed, and the onslaught lost some of its impetus. Madrid, however, remained the focus of battle for the next 4 months. Dropping the pretense of non-intervention, Germany and Italy officially recognized the Franco regime on the 18th of November.
The Non-Intervention Committee, which met in London, usually under the chairmanship of Lord Plymouth, was a gathering of representatives of various countries who had adhered to a French idea, which was that people should sign a declaration that they would discourage intervention in Spain and really try and isolate the Spanish Civil War. The momentum for its continuation was as much, I think, British as French as time went on, and the British described the non-intervention policy as being like that of a dam which held back the waters of Spain from spilling out all over Europe and starting a European war between the various powers, which of course had sympathies with different sides.
The Basques had formed a so-called iron ring around their capital city of Bilbao. German guns battered the Basque positions, but against the tenacious defenders, progress was slow. In the catalogue of ignominy that trails behind the nationalist campaign, the events of the 26th of April 1937 must surely rank as one of the most infamous episodes.